Let's assume your crew is assigned sortie number 8 of your unit's emergency war order. You were launched under positive control some 2 hours ago, and the closing rate to your assigned target is 7 miles every minute. You don't know whether this is the real thing or not. You won't know until you've reached your go, no-go position. The technical details of your aircrew duties are second nature to you. You know your business. And through past experience, you know that every detail in your combat mission folder, the route, refueling areas, turn points, IPs, and delivery tactics, has been carefully planned and cross-checked by the most highly qualified staff of combat planners available. In the mission planning stages, your particular sortie has been flown and reflown. IBM computers have been freely utilized to feed adverse planning factors into your sortie, cranking in varied power settings, worst wind factors, loss of engines or power, as well as high and low delivery components. In all this, the planners aim to assure you the best fuel pad and time distance separation obtainable from weapon effects. You, yourself, have flown profile missions over and over again on USCMs and ORIs, and you know that the missions, whether high level or low, can be successfully accomplished as indicated in the tactical doctrine. But there is one area in which you've had little or no actual experience: nuclear effects. So it is understandable if there is an air of uncertainty about it in the back of your mind. In reality, an abundance of experience on nuclear effects has been accumulated over the past 14 years. Hundreds of men have flown nuclear test missions in conjunction with detonations of high yield and low, both in the Pacific and Nevada test operations. This experience has been funneled to your combat mission planners so that your route beyond the H-hour control line, commonly referred to as the HHCL, can be planned with maximum safety. These nuclear effects criteria have as much, if not more, influence on your role in the emergency war order than any other operational factor. This phase of planning is particularly vital in today's multi-bomb raids, when your route must be plotted to avoid not only the effects of the weapons you release, but all weapons dropped in your general area by adjacent strike forces. All planning computations are carefully refigured and cross-checked by the planning staffs of your wing, numbered Air Force, and SAC headquarters. Equally valuable is the continuous scrutiny you and your fellow crewmen give to your own assigned sortie in relation to adjacent missions. The combat mission planners know there is no minimizing the awesome nature of this nuclear force, nor the extent of its effects. Here is a general refresher on each of these effects: thermal, blast, and radiation, presented in their relationship to your aircraft. Thermal, the light and heat hazard, radiates from the detonation in two phases. The first phase is instantaneous, comprising only 1% of the total thermal effect. Yet, it is this phase of the pulse, occurring quicker than the normal blink reflex of the human eye, which is responsible for flash blindness. You must be about 80 nautical miles away to avoid even minor flash blindness when looking directly at the detonation. However, your thermal curtains keep out all but a minor portion of the light. The second phase of the thermal pulse is long and cumulative, with the heat energy building up on the aircraft like a hand held too long above a match. Whenever there is new snow on the ground or clouds above the flight level, some additional thermal effect is received. However, the aircraft skin, coated with white paint, reflects most of the heat, and the airflow over these surfaces further reduces the total heat absorbed. Also, the thermal curtains can withstand tremendous heat, almost twice the amount anticipated. After the thermal hot foot has passed, the shock wave arrives with its twofold effect of overpressure and gust. Overpressure, the sharp increase in pressure, consists of successive positive and negative phases which produce a wraparound crushing action. Overpressure is the dominating effect at low altitude. With the vulnerable structural parts of the aircraft being the bomb bay doors, radomes, and access panels. Gust is usually the dominating effect at high and medium altitudes. Gust loading, similar to atmospheric turbulence, gives your aircraft a sharp jolt as it builds up on the lifting surfaces of the wing and horizontal stabilizer. Nuclear radiation consists of instantaneous bombardment of gamma, neutron, alpha and beta rays, followed by radiation particles in the nuclear cloud, which later becomes fallout. Instantaneous radiation can be dismissed because of your distance from the burst. Fallout is a ground problem. As an air crewman, you need only be concerned with the nuclear cloud and the safe separation times given you by the EWO planners. This will be discussed later. In concluding this general rundown on nuclear effects, here is a representative chart showing the limiting envelopes of radiation and thermal compared to those of overpressure and gust. It took years of actual testing, millions of dollars, and a wealth of scientific and technological know-how to determine these envelopes on which your safe separation times and distances, as well as delivery tactics, are based. Shortly after the Hiroshima and Nagasaki results expanded concepts of warfare into atomic dimensions, men from the armed services, the Atomic Energy Commission, and scores of scientific laboratories began trooping out to the Marshall Islands in the Central Pacific and to the desert wastes of Nevada for periodic nuclear weapon tests and weapon effects operations. Our interest concerns the effects testing, particularly the vast amount of time and effort devoted to gaining effects information on aircraft structures, from the crossroads operation all the way to the hardtack effort. On Crossroads, a modest beginning was made when the Navy placed instrumented aircraft and separate components aboard its test ships in Bikini Lagoon. The kiloton yield Able and Baker shocks provided only a smattering of blast and nuclear radiation data. Operation Greenhouse, Aniwetok Atoll. Besides instrumented aircraft components set out on the islands in the vicinity of several kiloton size bursts, instrumented drones skirted the burst area to gather blast and thermal data. While preparations were made for the next test operation, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology utilized the Crossroads and Greenhouse findings to begin developing the concept on which the current SAC effects doctrine is based. 1952, Operation Ivy, Aniwetok Atoll. The first thermonuclear detonation, known as the Mike shot, was achieved. Mike was a liquid fuel experiment, but its success proved out the fusion principle, paving the way for the equally successful dry material version, patterned for more practical weapon utilization. On Ivy, instrumented B-47 aircraft were sent aloft to be tested at 50% of thermal design. B-36s were tested for both thermal and gust loads, also at approximately 50% of design. 1953, Operation Upshot Knothole, Nevada, again featured kiloton yield bursts. In addition to B-36 and B-50 aerial testing, ground tests were conducted on aircraft of several types, exposing them in various orientations to surface and air bursts at graduated overpressure levels, many beyond the breaking point. The aim was to verify laboratory tests and analyses concerning failure modes on aircraft through overpressure and gust effects. Operation Castle, Marshall Islands, involved aerial participation in megaton-size events by B-47s and B-36s. These aircraft, like those in all operations, were extensively instrumented by the Wright Air Development Center. For the B-47 test aircraft, interest centered on the effects of radiant heat on the aluminum skin of the ailerons. Thermocouples mounted at selected points in the skin and supporting structure gave temperature readings, while radiometers and calorimeters in the fuselage gave thermal time history and total input. A variety of blast gauges and cameras mounted under the fuselage aimed at zero to assist orientation calculations completed the array. On five successive pre-dawn shots, the B-47 flight pattern at 35,000 feet was selected to position the aircraft where its aileron skin would receive the maximum allowable temperature rise to 370 degrees. In all instances, the maximum skin temperature rise was substantially lower than predicted. Heat damage in all cases was minor, involving only some patches of blistered paint at various points. The highest overpressure recorded on these five missions was around a third of a pound. 1955, Operation Teapot, Nevada. Teapot's most ambitious aircraft structures test involved three F-80 drones to investigate lethal blast effects at shock arrival time from a 22 kiloton tower shot. Each drone was completely instrumented for loading input and structural response data to check laboratory analytical predictions. Test results were obtained by telemetering the data to ground stations. The aircraft were positioned directly overhead at altitudes of 3,800, 4,300, and 5,100 feet. At the burst, high-speed cameras under the canopy recorded the crucial seconds of impact. The wingtip instrument pods of the lowest F-80, only 3,800 feet above the burst, were blown off with a shockwave. As this drone was being shepherded back to a landing, radio control was lost and it crashed. The other two drones suffered relatively minor damage. The middle drone was brought in without incident. While the top aircraft's nose wheel collapsed after landing, resulting in the drone's pileup at the end of the runway. The results of the F-80 test had important application to in-flight blast response for all types of aircraft. Also on Teapot, this array of vertical stabilizers placed close to the burst provided information on structural response under gust loading. Operation Red Wing in the Marshall Islands featured structural testing on a variety of aircraft, including the B-52 and B-47. The latter aircraft was oriented side-on to detonations for the first time. One heavy bomber project on Red Wing was concerned with the effect of gust and overpressure on an aircraft structure just after it had been heated by thermal. During these tests, thermal loads as high as 200% of design were recorded, along with gust loads which ran between 95% and 115% of design. These tests raised thermal design limits to 600 degrees Fahrenheit for the B-52 and 500 degrees for the B-47. Throughout the years, on selected weapons test operations, SAC aircraft and crews participated to refine operational procedures. Perhaps the most significant was the IBDA project on Operation Red Wing, where SAC crews of the 301st Bomb Wing flew simulated delivery and breakaway maneuvers above six weapon detonations ranging up to 5 megatons in yield. It is interesting to note the increased confidence of these crews on successive missions. On the first event, crew timing errors resulted in one aircraft being 2.5 times further away from ground zero than scheduled. On the second event, this error was cut to 7 seconds in time, or less than 1/10 of a nautical mile in distance. On the third event, the error was reduced to 2 seconds in time and a negligible amount in distance. During ensuing missions, each aircraft was at the assigned spot in time and distance. On Red Wing also, a research and development air crew accomplished the first delivery of a megaton bomb by a B-52 bomber. During the hardtack operation in 1958, the B-52 participated in 14 missions without blast or thermal damage. Significantly, the bulk of these missions were oriented to produce side-loading effects to determine the B-52's capability for multiple delivery strikes, where blast and thermal loads could be received at any angle from weapons delivered by other aircraft. Throughout the period of atomic testing, the hazard of nuclear radiation peculiar to fission and fusion weapons received a great deal of attention. Since delivery aircraft need to be concerned only with the nuclear cloud aspect of radiation, this report will be limited to the cloud studies. In the earlier operations, drone aircraft penetrations established safe parameters for the manned fly-throughs during Operation Teapot in 1955, when Air Force pilots flew T-33s through atomic clouds over Nevada 17 minutes after the burst. The first megaton cloud penetration study was made in 1956 on Operation Red Wing. Manned B-57s made 27 fly-throughs, the earliest 20 minutes after detonation. These test results formed the basis for the safe separation times listed in the EWO. Additional penetrations by B-57s during the 1958 hardtack operation verified the Red Wing conclusions. Throughout the years of nuclear testing, field operations were closely tied in with laboratory and aircraft plant activity. To gain vital time, much of the effects experimentation was first simulated in the plant workshops and research facilities before proof testing in the field. After each operation, findings were checked and cross-checked. Data on yields and distances from the bursts were projected into effects measurements on untried weapon yields, with results verified on ensuing operations. As experience and data were accumulated and methods were perfected, laboratory predictions became increasingly accurate. Thus, from the often lighted crucible of atomic test fire and attendant laboratory work were collected the substantial array of results utilized to influence the planning of a safe route for you beyond the HHCL. This route planning, in turn, stems from a complex target assignment undertaking which began long before SAC headquarters issued its current EWO with your sortie number in it. When high-level target agreement has been reached, the Joint Chiefs of Staff assign SAC headquarters its quota of targets. Both targets and priorities are determined by national policy and the latest intelligence information. Shortly thereafter, the combat planners from the numbered air forces descend on Offutt Air Force Base to work out the target area allocations for each tactical unit. IBM computing units are utilized to work out this distribution, taking into consideration such factors as base location, type of aircraft, geographical area, and target priority. The next step, sortie by sortie detailed planning is held at each numbered Air Force headquarters with representatives from each wing. While these men shape up the numerous requirements for each mission for the next EWO, they are fully aware that close by, in the command post, communications links to SAC headquarters and its worldwide network are under ceaseless scrutiny for the signal to execute the existing EWO. In the planning conference, each sortie is ground flown from takeoff to landing, its route dovetailing with that of every other mission. The nuclear test results are now applied to provide safe separation from other targets, as well as time separation from other detonations within target complex areas. The planners route you to obtain distance separation, or on rare occasions, change takeoff times to provide timing separation between bursts.
Well, how's it going?
Sortie 1 is okay with the separation criteria that you've given to me. He can avoid this DGZ by breaking right after the target. We do have a problem with Sortie 2, however. He can avoid these DGZs by breaking left. But my performance engineer tells me that he will be out of fuel prior to reaching the post-strike base. We've got to take him through this area somehow.
Yes, I remember this complex. As I recall, this is the last bomb down for option 1. We'll have to keep track of the timing on this to make sure that it doesn't change in other options. Well, let's go over to my desk and check this out.
When all sortie planning throughout SAC is completed, the results are run through SAC headquarters IBM Center for a cross-check. It is during this runoff that precise weapon effects criteria and timing of all sorties are compared. Conflicts resulting from timing compression into the various launch options are adjusted. The final IBM runoff of the Annex F of the new EWO contains the exact target times for all launch options. The new EWO is now ready for adoption. In films, such as you are now viewing, as well as through specific briefings given you from time to time, you have been given an indication of how nuclear detonation effects concern you, the air crewman. For more detailed study, SAC's directives and manuals make this material available to you in various forms. All in all, the factors involved form an overwhelming mass of facts and figures. You cannot be expected to remember all the details, particularly beyond the HHCL, when you will be totally absorbed with the immediate pressing duties associated with your aircraft. So, it is reassuring to know that the documents in your combat mission folder stowed aboard your aircraft represent solid results based on countless man hours of work done for you by the EWO planning personnel. For one never knows when. So you bore in past the HHCL, all six of you wrapped in this metal cocoon like a submarine crew beneath the sea. For the next few hours, except for the pilot's glimpse of the passing countryside during low-level operation, your only contact with the world outside will be a sporadic wink of light, followed by a sharp jolt.
Pilot, this is nav over turning point number 12. Change heading to 061.
Roger, 061. Keep our course and timing right on the nose, boy.
That weapon from Blue Sail is about to go down on that government control center off to the left. I hope he clobbers their fighter field, too.
Roger. Guess that makes the war official, man. Keep those curtains buttoned up. We're getting a shockwave in a few minutes.
You've hit the IP on the button approaching your target.
Pilot, this is nav. Pop-up point in 5 seconds. 4, 3, 2, 1.
Now to get that separation distance between you and the burst. You close your front curtain prior to the flash. The thermal heat builds up. Now to get back to altitude and start the long road back. It seems like the long way around to get to your post-strike base, but you remember working out an interference problem here. If you were to continue on this heading, it would place you within 7 nautical miles of the burst from a multi-megaton bomb scheduled about this time. You recall griping about your rerouting, particularly because this new heading takes you almost directly through the contaminated cloud of another bomb dropped 30 minutes ago. Like the rest of your crew, you are resigned to this lesser evil. From now on, the stage becomes less crowded as you move back toward the safe side of the HHCL. Yes, it could happen. If this nightmare situation ever materializes into grim reality, you may have a real bear by the tail, but at least you are assured of escaping the nuclear effects of our own weapons. The years of testing and analysis have enabled SAC to evolve a workable plan for every sortie to and from the target area. You and each crewman of the Strategic Air Command can have this assurance as you rigidly follow your flight plan, especially the part marked Beyond the HHCL.